Hi, this is Betsy Scott. In this session, we have Natalie and Paige at the wheel. So I'm going to sign off in a moment, but wanted to take a second here to thank our partners for their support for today's sessions and all of our other programming for the year. So thanks so much. Take it away, guys.
Hey everyone, I'm Dan Wu. I'm Privacy Counsel and Legal Engineer at Amuda, an automated data governance platform for analytics. I'm a huge advocate for data ethics and inclusive urban innovation. I'm really excited to share our panel today, which is focused on home as a service. Really, we see this as a new trend to build long-term relationships with our key customers, and it takes cues from other disruptors in places like hospital and transportation. The goal is to use new technologies and data and digital services to build an ongoing dialogue with consumers and build more responsive housing. In this session, we'll be focused on a couple of opportunities that can draw new insights into how we can build more convenience and better quality of life, such as through online home care management with Homezada and integrated home and health models through Safari Homes. So we have two amazing speakers, which I'll introduce. The first is Elizabeth Dodson. She's the co-founder at Homezada, a mobile and online solution to help homeowners manage one of their largest assets, their home, in one central location. By providing richer customer engagement to help homeowners, their solution gets increased retention referrals from their clients. She plays a multifaceted role working with partners, sales, marketing, social media, digital marketing, PR, financial, and budget review, and more. She has over 20 years of experience in the technology field. Prior to Homezada, she offered strategic planning services to software and internet startups. Manzur Khan is the founder of Safari Homes, which has the mission of healthy home, healthy community, and healthy world. He's leading a community housing project focused on integrating healthcare and housing as a service, focusing on moms, kids, and senior citizens living in harmony. At Safari Homes, he's the director of innovation and sustainability management. Prior to Safari Homes, he spent the past 9 years working at the intersection of healthcare and information technology, helping to improve care and quality of life as an integration architect with Cerner Corporation and others. So our first speaker is going to be Elizabeth Dodson. So I'll let you take it away, Elizabeth.
Thank you so much, Daniel. I really appreciate everyone having me today. And this virtual staycation, I think, is amazing. I think the team has done a fabulous job. So kudos out to the team that put this on. But I wanted to also share with you about Homezada. And we're going to talk about two sides to the same coin. And part of that side, what we're going to talk about is digital home management for homeowners, but also the ability to be turnover, warranty, and loyalty programs for builders and those in home management. Next, please, Betsy. Homeownership is a journey. Betsy, I'm going to ask you to click a few times. Go ahead. Thank you. And we own, and we sell homes. And many of us have done this multiple times in our lives. But one of the things that we realize is that once we start owning a home, especially for those who are inexperienced homeowners, we get frustrated. And there are some challenges that set in. We start realizing that we're underinsured. We are over budget on our remodel projects. We have unexpected repair costs. We lose track of the equity in our home. And we have data scattered everywhere, which only leads to more frustration. Next, please. So Homezada is actually here to help solve this problem. And this is how we talk about it from a consumer perspective. But we do this through multiple aspects in the system. And it's a device that can be used on any device. It has high levels of security because we have to meet the needs of certain regulated industries, but we also have to maintain the customer privacy, which is really key to why we're here. The other thing that we look at is our goal is to help homeowners be the smartest they can be about home management. And because of that, we have homeowners in all 50 states and in 20 countries outside the United States. But our users are also mainstream America users. They're in all different regions. And then because of that, surprisingly, they're all generations. We actually thought our users would be one particular generation or one particular type of user, meaning a male versus a female or female versus a male. It's right down the middle, both men and women, and it's all generations. Next, please. So how do we do this? We do this through a suite of apps. We start off with a dashboard that provides personalized reminders and recommendations. Then what we have in our inventory is we leverage unlimited photos, items, documents as well as video using AI recognition to help identify and complete an entire home inventory. All of our insurance companies encourage us to do that. Then we move into our maintenance calendar and we send reminders to our homeowners that are personalized for them on the tasks that they need to do to keep their home running efficiently. From there, we stay in budget and on time with Homes Out as project templates to guide them through the remodel process. Knowing the value of your home, our home's equity, and when our mortgage will be paid will explain the total cost of home ownership, which we now know is scattered everywhere. When we want to sell our home, we can take a subset of this data we found in Homes Out, market it on a public site, and share it with a new buyer. And then that becomes Carfax for the house. And let's face it, managing multiple homes is challenging when you don't have the right systems. So Homzada enables the ability to manage multiple homes because everything is in one central location. And that's really important for those people doing that. Go ahead, click through, Betsy, and click one more time. And then you can see from our consumer perspective, we have a subscription model that they can use this system and sign up directly if they choose. Next, please. Now, the other thing that we have at Homzada is we have an opportunity for a huge ad platform. Today, we reserve this ad platform for our strategic partners. However, our goal is to connect all of the maintenance tasks, projects, insurance, service providers, products that homeowners need at the time in which they need them. And we can do that in various locations within our product. So it's highly targeted, it's relevant to the user, and then we can lower the cost to all of our partners in their opportunities to advertise their products as well. Next, please. So what's the value to homeowners? That's one of the things we wanted to talk about because people always ask me this. So first of all, they can prepare for properly being insured. 70% of most homeowners are not properly insured. They forget to go to their insurance agent to identify new projects, identify what new purchases they've made, et cetera. Making sure we maintain our home not only creates an efficient home, which ultimately saves us money, but it also creates a safe and healthy home. I can't tell you how many times I hear people tell me, I didn't change my air filters and I'm wondering why my kids have asthma. It's really important that taking care of our home keeps us healthy and safe and also efficient. Managing those finances, once again, understanding the total cost of home ownership. When people have all of their data in one location, they're also better organized. So their time is affected as well as the money that they're spending on their house. Their projects will stay on time and on budget, not to mention they'll have documentation for when they want to sell their house. And that's also really important because sometimes that has to do with our capital gains, depending on which state you're in and also which projects you've done. And then obviously differentiating your home when you want to sell it. If you've maintained your home and had certain projects done, that may be more valuable when you want to sell your home. Now, next please. One of the things we go to market, I've just told you the first side of the coin. We go to market B2C. Next please. We also go to market through our partners, and we have a series of partners. These are four key industries that we go to market and target. However, we work with many others, but these industries are all challenged by something very similar, and it's how do we engage our customers beyond that transaction of either selling a home, securing a mortgage, securing insurance, etc. How do we do that? And so we want to help our partners stay connected throughout the entire homeowner journey. Next, please. Now, for the builders here on this call, there's a lot of things we can do. And part of that is leveraging a digital turnover package. Rather than handing someone a physical package or binder to manage their home, giving them the tools they need, meaning the homeowners, to manage that home ongoing. This in turn reduces paper and storage for the builder. It also allows them to identify with going green. And then offering photos, descriptions of finishes, appliances, and equipment is now easier because it's digital. And that also plays a role, not only with your business, but also the vendors you use. Next, please. In addition to this digital homeowner package, we also look at how you can put all your different documents in the system. So the documents in the system also play a role in terms of your closing documents. You can actually add all that into the system right away. Next, please. So with the digital homeowner package, turnover package, excuse me, the homeowners can also access the preventative maintenance. One of the things that I've learned from many of the builders is that a standard suggested maintenance calendar is given to homeowners in a binder or in a little booklet. This can actually be automated to make it easier for the homeowner to take care of their those tasks. But more importantly, it also helps with any warranty issues that could come up for yourselves as builders. Having the homeowners take care of this responsibility and giving them those tools, they will then be more likely to do the maintenance that needs to happen. I can tell you, most of our millennial customers are looking at this particular area of our system because they buy a house and they don't know what to do once they own it. So next, please. In addition to the branding and the solution, excuse me for a second. So HomeZada allows for branding in the solution, and it's a co-branded effort. And this branding is really important because our users are in the system between 2 and 4 times a month. Think of it like a financial app, and they're in it for 11 minutes at a time on average. It's really important because that's a long time to be in a system. So they're actively using HomeZada. This information is displayed on all devices, and it's also in the emails that come out of the system. So there's 5 to 6 impressions per month to stay connected to your customers so that they can eventually send you more referrals and also remember your organizations when they want to buy another home. Next, please. So we do this through our product called HomeZada Professional. And HomeZada Professional also identifies with creating templates for our builders. And one of the things we know is that most builders don't want to start over and over and over by creating a digital turnover package. So we speed up that process by creating these templates that allow them to have a repeatable process, streamline all these different activities, and then they can manage all the information about those properties and then transfer that to their homeowners. And this also keeps those customers engaged with not only the property itself and the tools that they're using, but also your brand. Next, please. So why is this valuable for builders? Well, one, you're already a trusted advisor by providing a home. So now you can take this and provide additional solutions to help the homeowner manage their home, which is what homeowners are looking for. And we did a survey with HGTV not too long ago, and homeowners actually are looking for the things that are in HomeZada. So it's really important. Improving your brand, we talked about that briefly. Also allowing you to increase those referrals and those net new customers that will come in because your existing customers are so satisfied they're sending you referrals. Reducing your cost, not only reducing your paper costs, but also reducing your storage costs, because with HomeZada Professional, you can retain a copy of that transferred property inside your own access of HomeZada, and that data is all yours at that time that you've transferred it. And then you reduce that process and that time to turnover. The other thing that you have is a competitive selling advantage. Be differentiated with your clients, especially with these younger generations who are looking for a greener path to managing their home, and also technology to help them with that process. And then finally, getting involved in potentially new business revenue opportunities is also very important. And what I mean by that is you have the ability as a builder to have an ongoing maintenance opportunity within your organization. I can tell you that my customers are asking for this regularly, and we do have a lot of maintenance customers maintenance contractors that are using HomeZada because they're creating an online concierge maintenance business for their customers, whether they have multiple homes, whether they have one home, it doesn't matter. This becomes a new opportunity to stay connected to your homeowners, but also to leverage the resources or the contractors that you do have that you may want to keep them busy as well. So it becomes a win-win-win. So next, please. I just want to say thank you. I do have my contact information in here in case anyone has any questions, but I'm going to leave it to Daniel to actually continue with this conversation.
Awesome. Thank you, Elizabeth, for that really awesome presentation. That was super helpful. I would love to bring up, before we go to Manzar, I would love to bring up a question that Rodney Hall brought up. He's asking, who's responsible for collecting and inputting all the data that's needed to use HomeZada? As we discussed prior to this presentation, there might be barriers to getting homeowners to adopt the technology given potential upfront time and maintenance time to do so to input the data. It sounds like you have a tool, for instance, you mentioned templates to kind of help with that. But could you kind of describe that process? Who's responsible for inputting the data, and how are you overcoming the barriers for people to input that data?
Yeah, that's a great question. So there's a couple of different areas where data comes from. So yes, some users do, there is user generated data that comes into the system, because let's face it, no one knows exactly what's in each home, and each home is very different in anywhere in the world. So that's the first thing. So user generated data is one area. The other thing that we do is we have predictive algorithms. So for instance, when it comes to an inventory, which is the most comprehensive part of the process, we actually identify, if you give us the number of bedrooms, bathrooms, and type of home you have, we will predict the generic spaces and the generic items in those spaces to get you going. The other thing that we also look at is, if you think, for example, the maintenance calendar, we also pre-populate the maintenance calendar with approximately 40 maintenance tasks, and yet our system also has an additional 150 that people can choose from to add to their calendar. So we want to make sure that we're helping the homeowners get started on where they may not understand how to get started. The third area that we have is video recognition. So video recognition in the inventory section, you can walk around with your mobile phone, take videos, and then our AI technology will take a look at, we think you have these items, and that's a speedy way to get an inventory done. So that's the other thing. And then with both professionals and with project templates, inside the system, we also do have templates to help people get started in that process as well, because we realize that there's a lot of homeowners that don't have project management or construction skills. And just to give a background on us, we all come from commercial construction project management technology. So we wanted to extend that to the average homeowner to help them make sure they manage this. And then the final area where we get data is we do have third parties where we do pull in data. So think about the financial aspects. There is a third party we work with to pull in mortgage data, valuation data of the home, and equity values as well.
That's awesome. It sounds like you're using a lot of best practices and understanding what people are already doing so you can pre-populate things. I think that makes a ton of sense to get people started, and then they have to do less cognitive work to understand how to get started. On that though, do you have some sense of like prioritization? Like, do you help homeowners understand, like, if you focus on this thing, this is going to create better, bigger benefit than item number 5 or 6? Is that part of your framework?
So it's not quite part of our framework. And the reason being is because we take a look at our customers, where they are in their homeowner journey. So a good example of that is if you're a millennial and you're brand new to homeownership, you may not own a whole lot of things. So inventory is not going to be a priority for you, but maintenance is an absolute priority, as is projects. If you've been in your house for a long time, then inventory is a priority for you. And that's also part of the free part of our product. So people get started there a lot. The other thing to keep in mind is when people are involved in projects, especially the major ones, bathrooms, kitchens, etc., getting prepared for those is a priority for them because they don't want to be over budget. Or if they are, how do they reduce that over budget spend so that it's not as significant as they had once thought it would be? And so that's kind of wherever someone is in their homeowner journey, that's where they start within Homezada. Someone who's managing multiple homes, they jump in at every place possible because they've got different things in different homes and different strategies to manage those homes. They may not have projects yet, but they definitely have inventory and maintenance in those aspects.
Fantastic. Thank you. So really appreciate that. Manzer, it's your turn, and feel free to take it away.
Hey, everyone. I hope you can hear me well. My name is Manzer Khan. I'm the director for Safari Homes for Innovation and Sustainability Management. So where our journey started, you can see the picture of three countries. I'm originally from Bangladesh. I was born and raised there. It's a country the size of Wisconsin as a state, which has 180 million people. So I want you to remember that because it has a lot of impact on the way we have our strategy. I lived in London for 2 years to study, and I have saw their row houses there and how uniquely they had condensed living community. And then I came to United States, and you can see the third picture. It's a dream to have space, but how much space is the right space? So that's where, you know, my challenge was to figure out that middle path. If you go to the next slide. So why we thought of this project? My background is in healthcare IT. Real estate industry is not my industry, but I felt the urge because of a soccer ball. You can see some text there. That's for the presentation. I will tell you the real reason. So the real reason is that the community I was raised in Bangladesh, we had one soccer ball for the whole community. And I used to own that. So when I leave the town, I have to give the soccer ball to somebody else so that my friends can still play. Now my daughter has 5 balls, but no one to play. I literally have to set a play date, drive her to a park and find her friends to have a play date supervised. So like any parents, you want to give a better childhood for your children. And I was thinking how I can create that community where my parents were confident that I can go out, play with my friends. And those friends are not from the same grade. They're different ages. And we learn from that kind of environment how to survive in a real world. And I'm not letting my children to have that organic growth. So from that why is Safari Home was born. That how we can create a space, a community where we can give the children a safe place to grow. So in Safari Homes, we planned, if you go to the next slide, our strategy is 3-pronged. So first we want to build efficient home. And what do we mean by efficiency? So there are 3 things that we target. We want to be energy efficient, a no-brainer, we should be. We should be space efficient. So when we build home, especially the single family homes that I visit for my friend's place, I see a lot of space, and for some reason, I feel that it's a lot of square footage that there is no value. So can we create more efficient space where people feel the value is there? And the third is cost efficiency. So anytime, you know, I think of buying a home, most times I do not feel that the value is there. Buying versus renting, I still cannot convince myself with the tax, with all the burden to maintain and the mortgage payment, still the value is not enough. So how we can create that cost efficiency to build new homes along with those energy efficiency and space efficiency. So that was one of our goals that we want to achieve. And then because I come from a population health management software company, how to give, you know, wellness as a lifestyle. As a health IT company, our focus is still in the hospital, that when someone is sick, we want to treat them. But how we can integrate the health data, the wellness data, and help people not to get sick in the first place. So that is our second goal at a community level. And the third goal is how to finance it. Now, anytime we talk about finance, we think about big investor, they're coming in, but they have their own agenda. And most times it's actually maximizing their profit. And that always do not align with the objective of the community building. So how we can finance it in an ethical way where the residents get the most benefit, and definitely there should be value for the investor as well. So finding that balance was our third goal. So if you go to the next slide, I'll talk a little bit about each topic. So in the efficiency for construction, my 2 cents, because I am not from the industry, I bring the analogy of Apple. So imagine if Steve Jobs would talk to every group of people to come up with the Apple phone. We might not have an Apple phone yet because that research would go on forever. My point is, if we can target a higher standard where we cover all the basic need and try to build rapidly that standard, and there should be some customization. We are not saying it would be cookie cutter, but the basic need for middle class is very common. So can we create a model home? And we are proposing this 40 foot by 48 feet side by side home that will have a 3-bedroom, 2.5-bathroom, very standard, 3 levels with, you know, attached garage. So if we can create a model home that we are calling a platform design and able to build it rapidly, so our goal is within 1 year, build it in 10 weeks. So every phase should be done in 10 weeks through seed panels and all this modular technology is already available. So I'm actually looking forward to industry, to the participant here, to tell us how. I probably do not have all the answers on the how, but the target should be something challenging, something possible but challenging. So that is where we are working right now, is we designed a side-by-side home that we want to implement this summer to have our first model home and tell us how we can make it better. So that's our first goal, but I'll go to the next slide to talk a little bit more about the community that we're trying to build. So because I told that I come from a healthcare IT background, it bothers me a lot when I see that people are not getting help when they need at their early, you know, adulthood. We should try to have a culture of healthy lifestyle. What we eat, how to, you know, live our life in terms of fitness and even as a family. So what is our goal is for every 200 unit, we want to build a community hub. And that community hub will cater their basic need in terms of health, food, education, even co-working space. I co-founded the first business incubator in Bangladesh in 2005. So business incubation and co-working space is kind of very dear to me. So the value that I want to add in this project, in this model, is that we'll have a co-working space, especially focusing on moms, young moms. So we'll have a daycare overlooking from the co-working space. So the mom can go back to work gradually from that co-working space, whether she's an entrepreneur or, you know, working mom, and the children could be in a very close proximity. So we want to create some values where people can stay close by. They don't need to have a car for every errand they run. How about some grocery there, some kind of meal kit prep center there for food? How about having some kind of food hall that multiple vendors can come and sell their food? Fitness center is one of the obvious one. We want to have, I talked about the co-working space, the basic healthcare, so urgent care, a pharmacy there. And those services do not necessarily have to cater only the community people. It can go to the beyond our resident and to the larger community to make it more sustainable. And this will actually take away some of the burden on the resident in terms of their HOA fees and the maintenance. So we want to make it a sustainable, viable model for everybody. And last but not the least, senior living is a topic that very dear to me, because I don't have my parents here. And I feel that, you know, those wise grandparents transferred their wisdom to the children. And not having that, I miss that. So how about bringing the senior living integrated to the community that they can live around? They don't have to be in a far place that we cannot visit them often. So that's kind of something that we want to build in this project. Last but not the least, the healthcare component is that we want to make sure that everybody is getting their basic need in terms of what kind of food intake they should have. So there should be a nutritionist in the grocery store to tell people, you know, what is the right food for them. And if they allow to share their data, we'd be able to help them. It will be definitely voluntary for every family. So that's pretty much where we're looking at in terms of the community wellness. So if you go to the next slide. How to finance this kind of project? I have heard from other panelists in this conversation today is we see the investor as a separate entity. And I always find the conflict when the residents' interests are not aligned with the interest of the investors. So in our model, the goal is to have integrated formula where the same people who's investing in our project could leave or can move somewhere else. Right now, the two major barriers that we find young people face hurdle to enter this real estate market is the down payment. So you have to save 20% down payment. Most people cannot save that much money. And they're forced to rent. The other thing is relocation flexibility, New York tomorrow or California tomorrow. So how to get flexibility and take away the entry barrier in terms of investment to real estate. So our model is crowdfunded. So anytime we take a project, there will be 40 homes and we'll take over the land, we'll develop the land. Excuse me. And at that point, we will offer it to people to be principal. So people who buy the land would be the principal for the project. And at that point, our own design that we already established, we will have the ability to raise fund, crowdfunded fund, build that house. So it's the same team who's going to build every house. So we are getting efficient by every project. We know how to build it fast and efficient. And that way, the people who are investing, whether they live in California or New York, they can get their rent, but still having that opportunity for the principal to pay off the loan amount and retain the full ownership. And we can roll that investment to the next project. So this is a very unique model. We are calling it an interest-free model. And our goal is to able to raise money, not only from USA, from anywhere in the world. And if it's owner occupied or owner is investing in a way where they feel I live in a different place, but this is where I invested 30% for one house, that gives them the flexibility to have a fraction of the ownership. So I can talk in details later about how this crowdsource model will work, but that's pretty much where we are focusing in terms of finance. So to the next slide, I just shared some rendering of our current project that we're working in Wisconsin. So this is the first project of 21 lot. We are building 40 homes side by side to have a lot of space for the community to walk, bike. And the last slide, if you go to the next one, gives a little bit of insight how we want to have natural light. The next slide, please. And energy efficiency integrated to our design. Next slide, please. So I have one more slide just to kind of give a view to the, yes. So basically we want to imply the efficient design model with natural lights and everything. So that's pretty much my concept I wanted to share. I want everyone to join this movement and tell us how we can make it better and work together. Thank you everyone for your time.
Manzer, thank you so much for that presentation. It was really illuminating. Really appreciate the story about the soccer ball. Before I jump into more general questions that apply to both of our presenters, I wanted to highlight a couple of specific questions to Safari Homes that came up during the chat. So for instance, one was just simply, could you kind of share, do you have like a floor plan of the 48 by 40 model that could share? Someone was asking that. And just to tie into that really quickly, someone was also asking about if you've considered pulling together other types of resources. So for instance, one large HVAC system for the entire community.
Sorry, I'm having a hard time to hear.
Can you hear me? Or shared car services.
I heard the last part.
I'll just repeat the question. So the two questions were, if you could share a floor plan of the 48 by 40 model, and if you have considered sharing other types of resources, such as an HVAC system or shared car services.
Okay, it looks as though we may have lost Manzer. If we need to, all of the questions are. Are you there? Okay.
I can hear you now. Yes. Sorry. So if I heard the last part, Dan, you were talking about how to have kind of a common mechanical, electrical, or whatever we can do as a community. Is that correct?
Yeah, someone was just asking if you've considered sharing other types of resources like HVAC systems or shared car services as well.
Definitely, definitely. So the way we see this is not one project. This is a space for people to bring in their own project, right? So we cannot own, and we don't want to own everything here. So yes, we will invite different businesses who are providing complementary services to come under one umbrella and kind of create a package, a one-stop solution. I'll just add in the extreme end is that shared car is very easy to do to the extent that we have planned to have some kind of microgrid so we can be self-sufficient in terms of even food security. Right now with COVID, we are talking about those topics. So we really want to try our best to reach practical sustainability within our community. That's our goal.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. And I'm getting a number of questions about sharing floor plans. Will you be doing that after the presentation? Can you share some floor plans so that other people can benefit from that? Or do you happen to have one on hand? Okay. Okay, cool.
I have one. Yes, I can share.
Okay, fantastic. So we'll have Manzer send that out after the presentation. So I want to start with some general questions that apply to this concept of home as a service. And so one of the things that we brought up in the very beginning was that this is an interesting way to build stronger customer relationships. You're essentially embedding a digital component to what you're doing. It's a lot more multifaceted. Homeowners are participating more in different types of services. In both of your projects, Manzer and Elizabeth, you mentioned a digital/data component. Could you share a little bit about what's working and what's not working and using your data appropriately to prioritize your customers' key pain points to understand what are the biggest things that are going to make the biggest impact as you're using your, as you're collecting your data? I do want to provide some context for this question. It really resonates with what Daniel Small asked. During your presentation, Manzer, he said that there are lots of different processes in Safari Homes. There's design building process, lots of different kinds of amenities. Again, going to this question, how do you ensure you're addressing the most important customer needs? So again, the question is about prioritization. How do each of you prioritize what is most important and how might data and the digital service component feed into that?
I'll go first. So our selling point for end user is still the home. I have to sell the home first before I sell the community. So we are focusing on a very efficient design for the home so that if someone comes and visit, they feel that there are components. So what are the challenges for the mom in the house that we can make it easier for them to manage through design, right? So we want to touch those pain points and make the homeowner feel that this design, this particular kind of construction process is adding value for their need. If we can do that, at that point, selling the community would be easier for us. So right now our focus in particularly, we are actually looking for lot side by side in our neighborhood right now that we want to build 4 units of this home. And we invite people to come and give their feedback and how we can improve that for our next project where we will have 40 homes. So we want to prematurely, and that's what we're trying to do now.
Elizabeth, did you want to comment on that? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so on our side, if you think about all the data that we're collecting, and I'm so glad that you're monitoring this, Dan, there's an ethical component that we need to address as well with all this data, because there's a lot of different information we're collecting from our homeowners. And the big thing for us is that we let our homeowners know that this is their data. The privacy policy is that we will not sell their data. It is theirs. They manage it. They take on the responsibility of it. Homesada is a custodian or a keeper of this data in a secure environment. And that's really important for our homeowners because they have to build trust with us in order to leverage this information and leverage our platform to track all this information. Now, they can share this information with whomever they like for, in a variety of ways outside of the system. And it could be through printing options. It could be through invite sharing options. It could be sending different types of documentation to a various different parties that they have. So that's really important that everyone understands that we're the custodian of this data, but the homeowner owns it and they choose to share it. The same goes for our partners. For instance, if a builder wants to create a package, a digital turnover package, they can then transfer that to the homeowner. The homeowner takes on the responsibility of their data from there, but the builder has a static copy of that information to manage and keep for their own records in case of some other situation that should occur years down the road. So they have a static copy of that in our system and it retains there and they own that data. The same holds true with if you want to get into the concierge maintenance business or the property management business. Our property managers have the ability to manage that data, but then they can share the data with their homeowners. And in that instance, everybody has access to the data at that present moment. So we make sure that we are tackling the privacy policy and making sure we keep that data. But if you think about it, it's about managing the contents of a home as well. And sometimes that's more than what's in most people's checking accounts. So it's really important that we maintain that privacy.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for giving that a lot of thought. I think that this question about ethics and privacy and secondary uses of data is only becoming more important as digital technologies are sort of observing us in our most intimate environments. Sort of the recent headlines that have come up about Amazon's Ring product, even though it wasn't necessarily inside the home, it was right outside the home, around the door, caused a lot of concerns, realizing that, oh, maybe some of this data is being shared with government agencies without my knowledge or without my explicit understanding. Another example is what happened with Google Home. There were, obviously it's capturing a lot of voice data, realizing that some of that was being transcribed by third parties, shared with third parties, a really intimate environment. So I'm glad that you're giving this a lot of thought because I think with the power of data comes, you know, in a very cliched fashion, the responsibility to wield it very well, because you don't want to harm that trust that is at the foundation of being able to build that long-term customer relationship. So I'm glad you're giving that a lot of thought. I do want to bring up one additional that kind of ties into this. So I believe we have about 5 more minutes left. So I'm going to add 2 quick questions, or they might be as quick as you'd like. But to this question of working with third parties. So there was a series of questions in the Q&A, and this actually ties back to the data and governance question around who can use the data, who can be involved, around how each of you may be partnering with other third parties. So for instance, how are you thinking about how your project is sharing data and integrating with things, people like builders and developers, other building and product technology supplies partners, and maybe even trades and services. So there were a series of questions around partnerships and how you're thinking about partnerships through your service platform. And how are you going to manage that? How are you thinking about that? How are you going to govern the sharing of that data and your technology responsibly?
That's a big question. Yeah, but it's a serious question. It's a big question. It's a serious question because Homesada has a long roadmap. We currently have third parties that we pull data in on behalf of the customers. This data is public data that has been pulled in. So note that, first of all, and then we put graphics around it and reporting around it, which is really important. The other thing that we look at is as we continue to partner with a lot of our different partners, they also look for how can I input data from my systems into your system so the homeowners get access to that. So that is their homeowner private data, and we deal with those privacy policies and regulations daily with all those different partners. Because if you go back to mortgage and insurance, highly regulated industries, so we have to be very specific with that. The other thing that we have is think about an inventory, and eventually a homeowner wants to share that with their insurance company. Can they do it simply with a click of a button? They can, but we also have to make sure that we're adding permissions into the system in order to do that. And that is something that we're working on with many of our partners. And that also applies to all of our other organizations that we work with, even in the building industry. How can we actually help those people connect with the right people at the right time?
Manzo, do you want to share anything about how you might be working with third-party partners? This is not just about sort of data governance, but just generally, like, how are you thinking about these other sort of stakeholders that are part of the housing innovation sector?
Right. So I remember at Cerner Corporation, so Epic and Cerner are the two largest healthcare IT company in the United States. And I looked at one of the presentation on population health for Cerner, and they talked about connecting with churches, grocery store, fitness center, even home. But I know there is no connection right now. Their connection is with the hospitals. So what we want to bring is that this kind of player like Epic and Cerner eventually give us the umbrella. And because they deal with health data, have all the security features so that we can feed that missing link, right? To provide the community data where they can provide us intelligence based on the data we feed. So our goal is to create enough value.
I think you might be frozen again, but just so in the interest of time, I just first, again, want to thank everyone, all the panelists, for your amazing insights today. It was super engaging and interesting. And also, again, to the Housing Innovation Alliance team, Dennis, Natalie, and Betsy, thank you so much for hosting this session. And so we can go on to the next. Natalie, I'll let you take it away.
All right. Thanks, everybody. We're going to...
Can you hear me?
Hello. We're going to move on to the next session. In between, we encourage you to go to the lounge and make connections. And next up at the top of the hour will be our first virtual think tank, where we'll have Kickstarters to start the conversation, and we'll be calling on others to participate. We'll see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.